I'll open the Wednesday, August 12th Conservation Commission meeting. And it being seven or after, we can start with RDA 2015-15, 239 at 243 Main Street. Curtis, Glenn Curtis. Is there someone here? Okay, if you do you want to talk about your project at all, or?
Sure. What it comes down to is that's a large four-unit condominium complex on Route 28. And in principle, what we have is a dumpster, which accommodates all of the residents. It's in the back left portion of the property, just off the parking lot. And what we're trying to do at this point is improve upon it, enhance it, make it better from the standpoint that it looks like it's needing rehab, from the standpoint that seemingly it's been neglected for a while. It's currently just got a cedar, 8-foot cedar enclosure on three sides. Primary problem is that there's also a tree growing within that same complex area, the footprint of that 12 by 12 by 18 area. And what we wish to do is remove that tree, take out and remove some of the existing material that's there, and put a permanent concrete slab in there so that JRM, which is the contractor for the disposal of the dumpster, to put that in there, and then at the same time put a probably chain link fence of the same size, eight feet enclosure with some sort of mesh or slap that will block the view. Mm-hmm. We'll have a large single entry gate for JRM to access the dumpster, and a walkthrough gate to allow for the residents to access that same area and to hopefully access as well the recycling. We have six large recycling bins, which are broken for plastic, paper, and so forth, that reside in there as well. So that's principle, that's just what we're after, just changing the enclosure from what it exists to better improve it, and also to comply with the Board of Health already, who said that you really have to enclose it and block its view. Okay. So that's really what our objective is.
And we did a site visit?
We did. I met Mr. Schaefer and Curtis on that evening. The tree you can see in that photo is a large maple, but it is kind of, there's some openings in the back, so there may be some insect damage there. They plan to take that down.
Mm-hmm. It's growing right out of the pavement?
Yeah. And the way that the area is sloped now, it slopes towards the back. What they plan to do is remove the asphalt and take up some of the dirt and then put in about a foot of stone. And they want to grade it so it comes back towards the parking lot. So there'll be a little bit more, I think, soil removed in the front of it, and then they're going to have to build it up, I'm thinking. There was also, beyond the stockade fence to the left of the tree, there was an old Christmas tree just thrown in there. And there's a swale. It's not really a swale. It's just an indentation. There's wetlands back there. There are a lot of trees down in there, but I don't even think that that is their property. So the wetland or resource area, I think, would be about 10 feet away. Mm-hmm. And then in back, it comes around. And I thought that, actually, no, yeah, that would be about 18 feet, 10 to 18 feet. You mentioned something in your RDA about having the wetlands delineated at some point.
Initially, I thought there was a need for, when I was reading, this is my first time around this type of documentation anyway, having some flagging done, and I was prepared to have that done as required or if necessary, and I was told that that need not be done at this time.
Okay. So, I mean, as long as they put in, like, erosion control, I'm assuming that that would be fine. It's pretty straightforward.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's no need to flag the wetlands. At least in my opinion.
It's pretty clear.
I knew that it was.
Yeah.
It's right there.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, I just have a question.
Sure.
In this project, is part of the plan,
is there now or will there be in the future some sort of like low curb berm, like some curbing around this enclosure, or is it just going to be flat slab without any curbing on it?
Done full planning on this. I actually have been waiting to get through this part of the process before I get into the contractor contact. But yes, my intention was to put a, as you will, three sides, an open
front open
to it
front,
where JRM can access.
Which it has to be.
But then put a like a four inch by 6 inch wide curbing on three sides, which would also hold the piping for the chain link fence. So that, yes, it allows us a better containment and allows us a better cleanup.
Okay.
I should point out that we, and I think it's in there, that we have, like yourselves, we're very concerned about the area, and what we want to do is make it basically right the first time, get it together so that when it's done, we'll have, and we still currently do, even though it's not the same arrangement, of course, but we have three times a week, we have the management company, which oversees the entire operation, which is Great North Properties out in New Hampshire. They have a representative that comes by, and part of that routine is for that individual to inspect and police that area for us. So that's currently going on, and that certainly is going to be improved where currently it's a bend over and pick up and put it into a bucket type of thing, anything that might be outside. With the concrete slab and with the curbing, I think you know, it's a lot easier with a broom and a shovel to get in there and clean it out and dispose of the material. So
I see that as an essential on this. I see that as a very important part that, you know, even if there is any water, let's say, I don't know the slope of the parking lot, but if that's a lower, if that's a down slope area in the parking lot, you know, you could get a lot of buildup and puddling in front of that if the drainage in front of that isn't good. You know, I don't know how the water, surface water, is diverted there, but I see that as an important part.
Yeah, you certainly don't want to put a curb and it's going to stop natural runoff and create a...
Right.
I mean, it seems obvious, but
right.
It may not until the first rainstorm. Oh, no, what happened?
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. There's mention, too, about some wetlands mitigation action. That was going to be part of your scope of work, or were you just sort of leaving that open, but nothing specified? So... What were you thinking about wetlands mitigation?
Well, at this point, I don't believe it was necessary to do the as part of that the bales of hay, but to go to a silt fence behind that property, behind that area, just to put that standard 3 foot high silt fence down 6 inches.
Oh, so you're talking about erosion control during work?
Yes.
As mitigation.
Right.
Typically, when I see the word mitigation, I think of as a permanent betterment of the area.
Oh, okay.
That's my perspective on the word wetlands mitigation.
My naivety showing up there. That's
yeah. Which I always encourage everyone who's to do, to feel free to take on some stewardship and some betterment of the habitat if they have an opportunity.
It's definitely going to get better protection. The runoff right now is from the well. We get no puddling or anything there. Any runoff tends to go to the rear of the dumpster.
Right.
There's nothing we can really notice, but obviously that's where it's going to go because it's rolling in the back. Underneath the dumpster is what's left of an asphalt surface. It's pretty well chewed up, and the balance of dirt and debris, small pieces of debris get down in that. It's very difficult to keep clean. And this patch should put an end to all of that.
Yeah, yeah. So just the repair is going to be a bit of a betterment right there. Yeah. Okay. All right. I didn't have any other questions.
Did I hear that you're coordinating with the town about the requirements for dumpster pads? And you said the health department, you spoke to the health department about it? Or
The Board of Health, best guess, three, four weeks ago, somewhere in that area, had done a site visit. And at that time, that was when they indicated it should be enclosed, and that's when we stepped up and said, yes, that's, you know, we're in agreement with what you're looking at. And they have, at this point, pretty much stepped to the background, and now, because of, we've told them the process we're trying to go through with yourselves and the timelines involved. So I suspect that we will, in fact, be communicating back and forth with them at some point as this moves forward, hopefully, from this process, and as we get further into the area of making some final plans as to what we're going to do, then we'll be communicating with the Board of Health, but to be in compliance with them.
I just, you know, it's beyond our purview. I just wanted to be sure that you were aware of that, because I wouldn't want you to have this plan and then have the Board of Health saying, oh, no, it has to happen this way. So the fact that you already spoke to them is good. Just an FYI, that's
all. Yeah, Joan Vitale is quite familiar with our situation.
Okay.
She really is.
All right. Any other questions or comments from the...
I have some questions. I don't know if Mike, you...
No. Go ahead.
So I had a few questions, and I would actually like us to not move forward on this, because I'm not sure of a couple things, because Glenn hasn't spoken with a contractor, and we don't know what this is going to look like. So is it going to expand? I think so. What is the base going to be? Do they need to pull up what's there, or can he use what's there? We haven't talked about how that happens and what that procedure is. I think I did ask you to start talking to contractors, but to allow you to do something before we know exactly what it is that we're allowing you to do isn't really where we want to be. It just makes it more stressful on the conservation office if we are telling you, we can't tell you generally do this repair. We need to know exactly what you're going to do. So that's my only concern.
So then at this point, as communication takes place with one or more contractors, as we look to see, and in connection with the Board of Health, pull it together, then make another appointment to perhaps see you.
Well, we could not close this hearing.
Right.
And you would come back with that information. I think what you're hearing is that we're okay with the concept of bringing this back up to, the standards of the health department. But we need to know what that's going to be. So when the contractor comes out and you pick your guy, he's going to write up a contract. And inside that contract, he'll tell you exactly what he's going to do. And that's the kind of language we need to know about.
So. All right. And that's just brought to your office?
No, you'll come back to the meeting and tell us all about it. You can drop some off at the office too, and I'll put it in the packets for the commission to read. But that's kind of my concern. What's going on? It's a little too loose at this point to know what we're agreeing to.
Yes, sure. Okay, so at that point we have some idea of rather than just the circle. This is where the pad's going to be. This is how big it is. Is there going to be a curve in the back? Where the fence post is going to go in? What's the base going to be? Do you need to dig more to get the slab in? At that point, we have a better idea of what's actually going to occur rather than, I think Chuck said it best. In concept, I think we all sound fine, but just to agree to a general, this is what we're going to do without seeing a plan is another thing.
Well, that's fine too. And again, I take it from the perspective, we're volunteers in a board as owners, and our concern is, like I said, getting it right the first time and getting it done, hopefully as soon as possible. But at the same time, this is the first go-round. So in terms of getting contractors, compliance with yourselves, compliance with the Board of Health, we're looking for assistance as we go too. So anything that you can bring forward to say, this is the direction you should go, and these are the contacts you should make, and this is the sequence in which you should do these, that's appreciated as opposed to, being an objection on our part.
So I would add to that right now you have a railroad tie type foundation that's kind of retaining this whole thing in place. my thought is your contractor's not going to say, let's just, that's good to move forward with. I think you're going to pull everything out and rebuild it for the next 30 years or something like that, and those aren't going to last. So my thought was, I understand, you know, what you're doing, but it's just how you're going to start with that foundation that I need to know. So you might do engineered blocks in there, you know, on the same footprint. I don't know what's going to be recommended, but you're bringing this up to date. And back in the day, it was started out with these wooden ties right here. So I think that's one of the things we need to find out about. So
sure.
So that'll be at your speed. Whatever you whenever you are ready to come back with a more specific plan, you let Chuck know, and he'll put it on the agenda. And in a second, I'm going to make a motion that we don't act on this, and we just continue it until you're ready.
Do you have a suggested date where you think you can get a contractor out there? We have a meeting every 2 weeks.
Well, I'd like to, tomorrow's my start, getting contractors. Now that I know what the agenda calls for and what we have to do. So, if we can get it on the...
So make a suggestion, we put it on the next agenda.
If
you can't make it,
August, we'll try to.
Just call us and tell you want to extend it from that.
Okay.
So I move that we continue the discussion for RDA 2015-15, 239 and 243 Main Street until the next meeting.
Second that.
All those in favor?
Okay.
Okay, see you at the next meeting then.
All right, appreciate it. Thanks for your time.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda being 7:10 or later, RDA 2015-14, 128 Grove Street, Duffy. And I see Mr. Duffy in the audience. Good.
We're back again. I had the pleasure of meeting Rebecca out there the other night on Monday. And the project we're doing is very similar to what we did at 132 Grove. We were in a month or 6 weeks ago. And there's no site work or anything going to be done to this. We have a cape currently, and we're just going to add a second level on it and make it a garage. There's no tree removal or no yards to be cleaned up or anything. It's just simply the construction of the building. And when I came down to get the building permit, Mr. Sullivan, I spoke to Chuck, and the house is within the 100 feet or whatever, so that's why I guess we're here this evening, just to make sure that we comply with the distance, I guess, of the house. We've kept the site pretty clean over there. We've gotten along with the neighbors, and we're literally doing the house just to the left of the house that we're currently working on now.
So, so you said no disruption in the back. You're just adding the second.
No, actually, when Rebecca and I came out, the yard is much nicer than the one I'm working with next mm-hmm. door. It has a real steep incline. There's no trees falling or any of the other issues I've had with the house that I'm currently on. So this one, it was maintained and owned and lived in by a couple that were there 50 years. So, mm-hmm. I don't want to change anything. The yard's really in decent shape. And I'm just trying to just put a second floor on with a couple
okay.
of additional bedrooms in the back.
All right, and you did a site visit.
I did.
Looks way outside of
it. The wetlands are down slope, and they appear to be about 80 feet. I didn't go down and pace them off. And it's just an addition on the second floor. The landscaping is in nice condition. He said he was not going to cut any trees. We did take a look at 132. Grove Street, and they had cut some trees there.
No, those were the trees that had already fallen, Rebecca. Those are the ones that were originally laying in the yard. They were up on the hill, Chuck, and they were the ones that fell, and we were cutting them up and then dragging them
yeah,
out.
Yeah, you still have some
yeah, I still
down
have some,
there
a little
that
bit,
need
yeah,
to
there's still
there
probably a couple of 10-foot, by 18 by 10 logs that we need to chop up and drag the rest of them out of there.
Yeah.
So way outside the resource, and we need that.
They're right at the wetlands, these logs. They're this big.
But
That's at 132.
That's yeah. not part of this
that's
application.
Not, nothing.
I mean, for this application.
Nothing.
Okay.
There's no cutting. There was nothing down in the wetland.
But your site visit note said. Oh, this is what you're talking about. The house on the north side
yes.
had some large limbs. That's
yes.
not part
132.
Okay.
Sorry, I didn't remember the number.
No, it's okay. I just wanted to clarify. So those are going to be removed?
Yes. We've been every week we spend a day down in the... dragging it up the hill. But it's a very, as Chuck will tell you and Rebecca will tell you, it's quite a hill to drag.
Are you using a front-end load or a bobcat to do that?
No, the only reason I had the bobcat I had over there because I had to put the cheap tree chipper in the backyard and I couldn't get the tree chipper in there with a pickup because I can't drive, I can't get in the backyard, so I had to use the bobcat to literally get the chipper in the backyard to clean the other side.
Any other comments on this application?
So just to be clear, none of your work is going to involve any trimming of any trees.
There's
no
need to on this site. As Rebecca and I walked through, there's nothing
to go vertically up. There's nothing in your way.
Up, nothing
there's
in the way. No trees that need to be trimmed.
Okay. And there's not going to be any. Is there going to be any backyard deck or patio or anything off the back of the house planned?
Everything that's already existing. It's not.
So nothing else is going to be done behind the house. All right.
Behind the house would be further away from the...
No,
no, it's closer to the wetland.
Yeah, it would be
closer.
The backyard is closer.
So generally checking it out, it was the entire house was in the high foot buffer. So
maybe
it's going to be But typically in a situation like this, where they're only going up and they're just doing staging, pump staging, whatever they're doing on that, we're worried about trash flying around, covering the dumpster.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, making sure that any cement and things like that and debris get kept up.
Right.
So that kind of stuff is what we're typically worried about. This is a better looking yard. Not much has to be done out there. So
I was very pleased to deal with this yard. I didn't want to deal with the same one I had to deal with last time.
Yeah. I don't have any questions. Any other questions about this?
All right. I'll entertain a motion for a negative determination on RDA 2015-14, 128 Grove Street.
Second.
All those in favor? They're all set.
Much. All right, thank you very much. Have a great evening.
You too.
Thanks for all your help. Thank you.
And can I ask who you are here?
Reading Municipal Light Department.
Ah, okay. All right, we can take that up then. And this was for the transformer clamp.
Brian, I just want to get it clear. You were going to entertain a motion, and Rebecca seconded it. So you need someone to make a motion, and we need someone to second it on this last one.
I move we issue a negative determination of applicability for 128 Grove Street.
I'll second it again.
Okay. Well, those
there you go.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right. 12 Landers Road, is that correct?
Landers Road,
right. Okay. If you want to give us a description and cool. I'm aware of what happened because Chuck communicated with me. I don't know the other members of the commission, if you could give us a little background.
I'm Joe Jamallo with Cushing, Jamallo & Wheeler. We're the environmental consultants, and I act as the licensed site professional for Reading Municipal Light Department.
Nick Aleva with Reading Municipal Light Department, and I'm usually responsible, the first contact for any sort of spill or environmental issues that we may have.
Okay.
So, do you like me to fill you in on what happened?
Yeah, if you could, please.
Okay. Sometime during the afternoon or early evening of August 4th, which was last Tuesday, During the heavy rainstorm that passed through, the pole-mounted transformer was downed and landed on the roadway surface at Landers Road. And if you folks have the
letter and figure that sent along to Chuck. It landed pretty much opposite or from number 25, Landers Road. Nick DeLiva gave me a call at home at around 7:45, indicating that they were aware of this down transformer. They became aware of that about half an hour earlier. At that time, and still to this day, we're not certain exactly when it actually happened. In any event, that transformer, we responded to the site along with Enpro Services, Inc. Out of Salisbury, Mass. They're engaged by Art Red and Light as the cleanup contractor. And that transformer had a capacity, there was a label on it that said 13.1 gallons. So essentially all of that liquid, except for a very small amount, made its way to the roadway surface and washed away with the rain. One thing I want to point out to you is that many the transformers these days have some kind of label or placard on them that talk about PCB content or non-PCB content. This particular transformer had no such label. So one of the first things that we had done out there is there's this portable testing kit, and Enpro had some of those, and they tested the remaining liquid in the transformer on a couple of occasions, and it came up non-PCB containing. Subsequent to that, we took a sample, sent the sample of the liquid to a laboratory, and got laboratory verification that it's non-PCB containing. In any event, so the majority of the rainwater impacted with this 13 or so gallons of, we'll call it transformer oil, it's also known as mineral oil dielectric fluid, or MODF, flowed down the right-of-way of Landers Road. Some of it did, according to the residents, and I assume the owners of number 17, Landers Road, stated to me that they had seen a sheen on water that was traveling down their driveway. I'll just stay on that driveway for a moment. At the end of their driveway on the northern side, there's a very small diameter drain, about 6 inches. And the folks there indicated to me that that drain flows underground in a PVC, I guess a PVC pipe, northerly to the next property. And just over the property line, right under a set of, I guess they're some kind of evergreen trees. We investigated that. You could actually, there's a stake in the ground there. You could actually see where the drain pipe daylights. There was nothing puddled there. There was no iridescent sheen or odor. We did take a sample of that. We're screening it, and we're sending a sample to the laboratory of the soil at that particular location. But getting on to the majority of the rainwater flowing down Landers Road, because it's essentially the rainwater heads north towards Van Norden Drive. A good amount of the rainwater ended up in the two catch basins that are opposite number 7 Landers Road. Those catch basins actually drain northerly through two manholes labeled MH1 and MH2, and then from MH2 it drains easterly along and under the 40-foot drain easement, and discharges at a small headwall on the property of number 12 and into a drainage ditch that appears to me to, unless it receives stormwater runoff, at least in that immediate area where it discharges to the drainage ditch, is dry has no running or ponded water unless it receives it from rain source. There was an area about anywhere varying from anywhere from 2 to 8 foot wide to about, I think I specified it in here, I think it was 30 or 60 feet long, that appeared to be impacted. And I use the word appeared, there was a odor of transformer or MODF. That's, we're all familiar with that. There was some iridescent sheen on some larger rocks or cobbles, detritus in the ditch. So that evening, and we worked early into the morning, my field person left at 6 a.m. the next morning. They had a pump truck, and they pumped out the liquid in two catch basins and did some other work on the site. We came back another day, I believe it was Friday, and we used what is known as a vector truck. It's basically a very large vacuum, very strong vacuum, and cleaned out the sediment in the two catch basins.
Joe, did you say Friday you came back for the vector?
I thought it was Friday.
I believe it was Friday.
Yeah, it was Friday. and prior to that coming back, I actually, around that day, I believe I spoke to Anika and explained to her the situation. But in addition to cleaning out the sediment in the catch basins, that vehicle, which was parked on Landers Road, extended their line to the area of the impacted drainage ditch and removed soil slash sediment and detritus over that particular area that I note in this letter, down to a depth of varying from 3 to 6 inches. After that was done, we've collected a few sediment slash soil samples, sent them to a lab for analysis. So then we're awaiting those results, which we should have probably either late Friday evening or the next working day following Monday.
Okay.
In addition to that, on yesterday, we had a vector truck out there again. And there were some areas along Landers Road where, just adjacent to the curbing, where some soil appeared to be impacted. So we removed that soil with the vector truck. All of this has been initially orally reported to the Department of Environmental Protection under the Massachusetts Contingency Plan. They've issued what is known as a release tracking number, which I note in this letter. And this is under what is known as emergency response actions.
Did we get the number for the YRTN?
Yes, it's in the,
it's
right.
It's in the report.
It's 3-33051. And so they're fully aware of what has happened, what is going on. And basically we're in a holding pattern right now to see what the laboratory testing results are like. One thing I failed to mention is we took a sample. If you stand in the drainage ditch and look at the pipe, there is sediment in that pipe, and it appears to extend for some distance up gradient in the pipe. We took a sample of that sediment and are having it analyzed to see if there's a potential it still contains any residue of the MODF. If it does, we're going to have that pipe jetted out. But as you probably can well imagine, within those catch basins, within that pipe, within the drainage ditch, there are probably petroleum hydrocarbons that have accumulated mm-hmm. there ever since it existed. Mm-hmm. Some from natural runoff of the pavement of the roadway, accidental gasoline drips, oil drips. So what we have done is actually taking a sample and of the oil and fingerprinted it, meaning that while we can test for, we're not testing just for petroleum hydrocarbons, we're testing for something called extractable petroleum hydrocarbons, because that's what we typically find in MODF. But we're fingerprinting it so that in some of the other soil slash sediment samples that we are analyzing, we're also taking fingerprints of that. Because I want to make sure, as Reading Light's environmental consultant in LSP, that what we have to clean up is only related to the MODF, not potentially some result of some other kind of miscellaneous spills, drips, or whatever that could be related to petroleum. So that's where things stand right now. And we, as needed, in a timely manner, will submit documentation to the Department of Environmental Protection on behalf of Reading Light. And certainly if you folks request it, we can do that too. And I do understand that you, depending upon whether or not we need to remove any more soil from the drainage ditch based upon the lab results we get back, you want to take a look at the results of our work in the drainage ditch to make a determination if any kind of restoration is necessary.
Okay.
I have a question or two.
All right.
You did an inspection.
I asked Chuck and communicated with Brian about reaching out to Mr. Jamallo, and we spoke a couple times on the phone, and he was very informative, and I appreciated that. And I also went to the site Friday afternoon after your crew had left, and I really appreciated how they left the vac tube. They left it completely sealed with duct tape so that, you know, no residue inside that tube could have been easily tampered with. I also went down into the area just down gradient of the outfall to just sort of walk and just get a sense of how much soil was impacted, what the soil color looked like, what the odor was, and all that. So, with that said, I have a couple questions, and maybe you can answer them at this meeting. They're just curiosity just begs the question. When you did that initial analysis of the PCBs here it is. It says on the first page, it's the big bullet. The big bullet at the bottom, it says the results were revealed that no PCBs were identified in the oil. Do you recall, or maybe it'll come in a further report, what the detection limits were for that one?
No, but okay. My recollection of looking at them, very low.
Very low.
I'm going to say, they'll hold me to this, but I'm thinking, well, certainly less than, I believe they were less than one.
Okay.
And I'm thinking point.
Tenth or, you know,
0.2
tenth
or 3
ppm
or something like that. So, you know,
okay.
Certainly way less than one would have to report under the Massachusetts contingent plan.
Right.
But I was pleased that the detection limits were so low.
Okay.
So.
That's great. That's, you know, especially if something, it's another indication that something is present in even lower concentrations if they can get to those lower detection limits. Otherwise, their equipment explodes with PCBs, and it's
right.
No fun with the lab, but the poor lab. But another question I had was, so that vac truck did get, I mean, I'm going to guess 40 feet maybe past the outfall. I don't know. You have measurements, but I don't need to know exactly. But the essence of my question is
60 feet.
Okay.
Okay.
The end limit was decided based on visual evidence?
Right.
Okay, so there was an actual
down
to some
odor,
degree.
I mean, certainly the greatest odor I had was right at the pipe where it discharged.
I could smell
but,
some.
And you could
yeah.
see iridescence So we generally went by that, but we took 3 or 4 samples. So we did do one at the extent, I believe. So we'll have a good idea.
Yeah. And that was on Friday, the samples?
Yes, the samples were collected on Friday.
Because these oils, they do tend to be more viscous than water, correct? And tend to smear. So if they are going to be present in a solid phase, not a dissolved phase, they're going to leave a residue. They're going to leave a solid surface. Yeah. When I first heard about the release, my biggest question was, is the horse out of the barn? You know, was this storm big enough to literally send the flush all the way past the outfall point? And I think I may have sort of put that to you in our discussion on the phone. So can you give us any clues or any information about how sure you are about, you know, a down gradient slug somewhere in the stream or in the wetlands?
I cannot.
Okay.
That's
still an unknown at this point.
Unless we took samples and had them tested.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to speculate.
Certainly no more when the tests come back.
But again, you know, I've been doing in my company, and I go back working with Reading Light since the 90s. And my company's been doing work for Reading Light since 2002. And working with transformer oil with and without PCBs, impacting various kinds of media, we have a pretty good sense of generally where it is and where it isn't, simply by sight, smell, and we do have portable equipment to do some of that kind of stuff.
To do the screening. Okay.
Inpro's been around for a long time.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, they've seen everything, I'm sure. So I guess at this question, I'm just wondering, what's your next deadline, and when's the next report, and when can we expect to see it?
The first regulatory deadline is 60 days from the date of oral reporting, so that would have been the 4th. So 60 days from the 4th, Reading Light has to submit 2 documents to the state by that 60-day deadline. One is what is known as a release notification form, and that's strictly a form, just detailing what I've already orally reported to the state. And one of the following two documents, either what is known as an IRA plan, which stands for Immediate Response Plan, or a Permanent Solution Statement. A permanent solution statement is basically a closeout document. So if we have investigated to an appropriate degree and we have cleaned up as necessary to meet MCP standards, then we can submit a permanent solution statement to the Department of Environmental Protection. Close out the release. If that is not possible, for whatever reason or reasons, then we would submit an immediate response action plan to the DEP, which describes what has already transpired and what our plan is going forward. So that's the first timely submittal deadline.
Okay. And at this point, can you predict which one of those two it's going to be, an REO or an IRA plant?
Well, my guess, I mean, based on what I've seen, I don't expect any, well.
Unless the lab reports
give you a surprise. My expectation is the soil results from along the adjacent to the curbing that we may have taken along the way of Landers Road, I don't think it's going to be a problem. Okay. You know, the drainage area / wetland, that's always a more sensitive area, and we all need to be aware of that. If those results show that there are issues there, then I'll be in contact with Chuck and let him know we're going to have to go back out there. So, to me, if we had to go back out there, that's the only reason. Or if we have to jet out that line from the street to the to where it daylights. Okay. So, one thing I just want to point out is I see that there's this work shall be completed by September 3rd. Well, I certainly hope so. Okay.
Well, you know, for everybody involved, the sooner the better.
Exactly.
You know, it's less complications. You know, it's better for the environment. It's better for the pocketbook of RMLD. It's, you know, sure. Everybody kind of wins there.
You know, and certainly, in the grand scheme of things, we are talking about 13 gallons.
Right.
Certainly, it is right. Oil, but. It's 13 gallons. It's not what I would consider a massive amount, a volume of oil. So.
Understood. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have some questions.
Yeah.
At the end of the concrete drainage headwall, you went out 60 feet to a depth of about 3 to 6 inches. The width, maybe?
2 to 8 feet.
2 to 8 feet. Is that the width of the drainage channel?
I think it varies. I think as you get farther away from the pipe, it expands a little.
So I haven't seen a vac truck, but I'm assuming it just sucks.
The truck's a huge truck, but
yeah.
The vacuum line, and we would all like to have one of those vacuum cleaners in our house, is a flexible corrugated shaped tube that's about eight inches in diameter, maybe something like that. And it's just a huge vacuum. And so that is what is used to vacuum up any soil or rocks or whatever. It's
and
very
strong. And I guess the drainage ditch along that was that vegetated drainage ditch? Was it wetlands?
My observations were after the vac truck had been there.
Oh.
And I had already seen my previous experience with vac trucks was on Harrison. Maybe when West Street and that road work in January discharged a lot of silt to a drainage ditch between two houses. Is it Harrison, Chuck? Do you remember?
I don't think so.
Howard.
Howard West.
Yeah, I remember that.
And that vac truck was like a coarse grabber. Whatever they were using. I mean, it maintained the fine root system of one of the trees that was within 10 feet of the culvert. So, like, it looked like a fairly careful job.
I'm going to get a quick look.
I guess my issue is there any potential for further erosion during rainstorm events because of removal of this material? Is there any?
So it's a pretty defined channel. It had some high walls, at least I would think so. That's it right there. And 60 feet out is probably where that last white tube is.
Yeah, gotcha.
And beyond that, there was at least another 60 plus feet, and then it kind of opened up into a flat area.
Plan.
So. I don't think it's going to jump the channel at all.
So you don't think that any restoration is required?
I haven't been out there since the work. I'm, you know, the 6 to 8 feet, it sounds like you went up over the bank and removed some material.
I wasn't there when he did it. I still have to go out and take a look.
Yeah, so.
No, I wouldn't go as far as to say no restoration is needed. There was some material removed, I think. To sort of reestablish,
that's the end of my power.
You know, a good infiltration area.
Yeah.
Before the wetlands, that's protecting the wetlands. That area, that little area where water comes in and ponds,
mm-hmm.
is keeping everything there instead of washing it downstream.
I think it could be pretty surgical for what they were doing and what they used, and as far as any material removed. You know, I haven't been there, but there's going to be that volunteer growth that's going to come in. Hopefully it's not invasive, but I don't know
if we're, you know, we're not probably going to get into a huge restoration. They didn't remove any, you know, 3 to 6 inches is probably just like the duff layer or something like that, so.
And I would suspect, given that the amount of sediment that's in that pipe, there's going to be more sediment coming out of that pipe at some point in time with every rainstorm to fill up some of that 3 to 6 inches that
it'll fix itself.
Right.
In no time.
And that was my only concern. If you're going to go, what's in the pipe? How's it going to get cleaned? If you have to jet it out, I mean, we're going to talk about this.
Well,
there's
a boom at the end of the pipe now.
There's what?
There's a boom, one of those white booms.
Oh, boom.
Okay. So how is that done? Well, typically it's jetted. Okay, meaning a jet of water, it goes down there. But what we would do is put either a vector line at where it discharges, right at that small headwall, or a pump truck. And so we would capture that water and sediment that comes out of the pipe. We wouldn't let it, the intent is not to let it run out into the drainage ditch other than just around where it comes out of the pipe.
So the only thing I would be concerned with what I've seen out there is there was somewhat of a plunge pool at the invert of the pipe, and if we're removing 3 to 6 inches from that spot, it's only going to erode more and it's going to have the capacity to come back. So depending on what that looks like, you might be putting a little bit of material in at the end there.
Particularly, that's probably going to end up being the spot where if you do jet wash, that's probably exactly where you're going to pump from.
One last question, just to be clear, those two catch basins at the bottom of Landers, CB1, CB2, was during when you were responding to the original notice, were those pumped out?
The liquid was pumped out.
The liquid was pumped out from them.
But the day that, I believe Friday, last Friday, when the drainage ditch was addressed, those catch basins, the sediment in those catch basins was removed also.
Okay.
It was removed, and I'm pretty sure it was Friday.
Okay.
In those catch basins.
Okay.
Do you know if those catch basins had a sump?
What do you mean a sump?
Well, a deep sump.
Well, I understood, and I can get back in this, but I thought my field technician said they had a solid bottom. But if your question is the base of the catch basin lower than the invert of the discharge pipe? Yes. I would say yes. But
I was told 3 feet.
3 feet.
That's what I was told.
It's not going to do any good with oil, though.
We removed the sediment that was in those catch basins that could have been impacted with whatever.
Because I know when I was there Friday afternoon, I sort of, you know, peeked into, I think it was catch basin 2,
mm-hmm.
which is closer to 12
yep.
Landers Road. And I thought I saw a sheen and could smell something. I just want to ask the question.
Well, I guess if we're going to be back there with a vector, we could always, and a jet rod, we could always pressure wash those.
When was that you saw?
It was Friday after they did the backing on Friday. So, and they went back and did more backing yesterday.
Right. So my intent is if the sample of the sediment from the drain pipe indicates that it may be related to MODF, my intent is to get the NPRO crew out there next week sometime to do this work, which would be jetting out that pipe. And if you folks would like the two catch basins pressure washed out, we can do that too.
Okay. I think it depends on what you find in the catch basin. I think if you continue to see sheen,
yes.
if there's some indication that there's
okay.
residual there, that
we'll
that will
that
be
out.
A continual release with every storm, I think it would.
Sure, we'll check that.
Another question I have has to do with records at RMLD. Is there any, you know, have there been any, you know, are there any records that on file that indicate what it is you're looking for chemically? You know, you say MODF, but it could hide under a couple of, you know, there's the fingerprinting analysis, which is going to give you a generalized answer.
Right, but
you know, and it'll, you know what I mean? So
the soil samples and the sediment samples that we're analyzing, we're testing for EPH, extractable petroleum hydrocarbons.
Yeah.
So what that entails, a little more technically here, there are three ranges of carbon fractions. Okay, and EPH is kind of like the, there's VPH and EPH. VPH is kind of the lighter stuff generally. EPH is the kind of like the heavier ones. We've tested many, many samples, soil samples, for EPH and VPH. We don't ever really see any VPH in MODF. So, you know, it's almost a waste of money, quite frankly, to test that now. So the EPH consists of three carbon fractions, I think two aliphatics and one aromatic chain,
and some
or
targets.
Vice versa. And then I want to say about a dozen. Other compounds, all if not many of which are PAHs, polynuclear aromatic hydrocarbons, and typically you're not going to see PAHs in MODF unless the transformer burned, because PAHs are the result of incomplete combustion. So if you folks all have grills at your home, the black stuff that's on your, where you put your food, that if you test that, that's loaded with PAHs. If a campfire, the residual wood that's there that's been burned, you test that, that's loaded with PAHs. So unless a transformer blows up, or, you know, you might, you typically you don't see PAHs, and therefore if I see PAHs in these samples, I'm thinking it's not MODF.
Okay. So you're going to be looking at the carbon fractions?
Yeah, primarily the carbon fractions.
Okay.
And also comparing some of those samples to the chromatogram that we get from the oil sample.
So you definitely have one sample there that you know was the MODF.
Yeah, we took the sample of the residual oil, whatever
from
small amount of oil was left in.
Gotcha. Okay.
So the next update would be the lab results.
Right, basically. And you know, we contact you probably next Monday.
Okay.
And I can I'll check.
All right.
I just have one more thing. I know you'll end up getting the lab results. I noticed on the plan, you know, there's indication of, well, the legend shows the soil samples, but I didn't notice.
Oh, that's because we didn't have put them on there yet. I'm sorry.
When we get the...
Mike got a little carried away. No, as a matter of fact, one of the plans that we ultimately will have will show the extent of the area we think was impacted by MODF-impacted rainwater, and where we have collected soil samples. That'll be a figure.
Right. Just want to make sure. Yeah, no,
I didn't realize that was in the legend.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks for the information.
Thank you.
All right. So, are you ready for us, Chuck?
Minor projects. We can do minutes.
So I have a couple things for you to sign. So let's not forget about Mr. Duffy.
It is.
Yes.
It
let's
is.
Continue.
There was
okay. It wasn't advertised.
You have minutes, and then you also have 306 Main Street to prove.
Yes, let's do the minutes first because it's easy. Maybe. They're not always.
We just don't leave before those things get signed.
Now, did we, is this the first we've seen in these minutes? Did you send them to us? Is it? Did these come in the email?
No, I got them off my email. She usually.
Did you not get a copy either?
I don't think I.
They were sent a long time ago.
I remember getting a copy of minutes. So these are probably the ones that came in the email.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I remember getting these.
Wednesday, June 24th. That was our last meeting, right?
Yeah.
Yep. No.
No.
Nope.
Did I give you the wrong? No, I didn't. Did I?
Maybe that's supposed to be July 24th?
I was going to say, because it has you as vice chair and me not present, and I know I was at the last meeting.
So this was, when I did a search, this was the last minutes that we received. So did anyone receive minutes?
I don't think I received minutes from the last meeting.
Okay, so she's on vacation. That's why she's not here tonight. So maybe we didn't get our minutes.
So
this goes over DMS.
I can't check. But I did, this was.
So then these are probably already approved.
Those, oh, yeah.
These
yeah.
probably already have, because that's yeah. Allison yeah. Stager on it. She's
oh.
No way. She's.
So, yeah, okay.
So we don't have minutes to approve.
We must have already approved these.
Yeah, we don't have minutes to approve.
We don't have minutes to
approve.
This was.
Do you have? Did anyone get minutes?
How many typos you caught last time?
No.
Oh.
I don't think so.
Well, they've already been approved, I bet.
Okay. Do you have the order of condition for 306 Main Street?
I do.
Okay. Can we have it, please?
Here it is right here.
I know you're multitasking tonight.
306 Main Street.
And the applicant's not here.
Right.
But he did call.
Okay.
And we always send it to the applicant. So this is the one we're going to sign.
Okay.
But he requests that the surety bond get waived for this project. So I have in there a $20,000 bond, and I told them it was going to be up to the commission.
Completely waived, he wants.
Well, he... I think the best way to represent Brandon would be to say yes, he wants it completely waived. That's his, where he's starting from. If you feel differently, then go from zero.
Well, I've got a quick question. I have a note that the last time he was here, you called on him to provide a little bit more beefier maintenance plan, operations and maintenance plan.
Right. So,
well, has that been provided?
It has not been provided, but inside the order of conditions, I set a
make
deadline to say that there will be no certificate of compliance until that is delivered.
I think that's what we talked about.
Yeah, and there's a pretty good one inside of this that they could just use that at the kind of like the last page. It kind of talks about street sweeping and all that, clean the gutters, and you know, four times a year with a report annually. So
what's what's the bond?
$20,000 is the. $20,000 is the bond that's required in the order of conditions, and he has requested to do away with that.
And what would be a reason to?
Yeah, so exactly. Let's just step back 1 second. So we do not give a bond for homeowners. That doesn't happen, okay, typically. So I wouldn't have that in that order of conditions. But in this order of conditions, when I send it out to you, it's draft. It's up to you to decide what you want to do. That is a boilerplate from some other order of condition, and that $20,000 wasn't based on anything, but the language is correct. And if you made that $5,000 or $30,000, that's why it's in there. So I didn't base my number of 20 on it. But I will tell you, when I talked to Brandon about this, I said, look, the commission would use the money to restore the site. This site is in miserable condition.
And that's
it's fairly flat.
Yeah.
And
I think there's little you can do there that's going to be worse.
What would we do? I mean, if nothing ever happened, which hasn't happened in the last 10 years.
Have you seen it lately?
Silt Well, yes, I have.
Yeah, we don't even want to go there. It's like way worse now that it's been. So
yes.
That's the staging area.
Yeah. Why don't you just put the staging area in the wetland?
Well, several phone calls have been made to Brandon, and Brandon's talked to that guy. And what happened there was the town kicked him out of their staging area because it wasn't a correct spot for it. And Brandon was contacted, and he said he put up silt fence, and which is my limit of work. So it can be very messy in the front. And several times I went down there, there was no silt fence. But the last time he said he was doing it, and I did see that it was installed.
I mean,
unless they've gone through that silt fence, they're really only a little bit beyond where it was dug up before.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not saying anything against Brandon. I'm just saying it's a construction staging area right next to the wetland. It's just not a great place for that to happen. You know what I mean? But that being said, where else are you going to put it? You know, for that project, there's really nowhere else on Main Street.
I think that was an appropriate spot to use for staging, as long as there was some sort of limit of work, because they kept on, you know, migrating backwards, and I needed to stop them.
Yeah.
More and more things would show up. So, yeah, you know, I'll look at it again, but
anyway,
we were supposed to have that in place. So that's, you know, the bond is up to you.
I feel the same way. You know, when you said that, I was thinking, geez, this site's...
Yeah, it's not like a road. We have to bring it up to standards or something like that.
We're not taking an undeveloped parcel and tearing it all up. And, you know, it's right now it's got a lot of pavement on it. As we speak, it's got a lot of pavement. And, you know, I just think, you know, what is the sense of the commission?
Isn't the bond... If they don't construct it like those rain gardens appropriately,
yeah, it's all that.
That if it didn't work,
and plantings,
that you'd have that reserve to go in and fix it.
Right.
Yes. No.
No. No. It would. You could use it for anything. And as a matter of fact, and I don't think it's in here, but we usually ask for like a 2-year period where we could
guarantee
partial. Yeah. I might be in that last page. But with partially keep some of the bond just to make sure that the survivability of all the plantings.
So am I hearing that the commission doesn't want to eliminate it? Is that what I'm hearing? Or
I don't think we should eliminate it. If we want it, if you know, I don't know. I don't know if we need to do a sanity check on the amount.
I think the amount's entirely too high.
I don't know the amounts. Like, I don't know what's reasonable or what would be an I haven't done any of this costing out, or I just don't know
the
cost
new,
that would cover it.
The new criteria, I used to say $350 per tree, if this helps you. $350 per tree, but I've just been told, and it's been confirmed by Bob Keating, it's $500 for each
tree.
Yeah,
that sounds about right.
Not bad anymore.
That's what Mass DOT goes
tree,
by.
I mean,
it's about $500.
They're not planting trees in the rain garden.
So we're talking about a herbaceous layer.
There are trees on the site, though.
There are.
They are planting, and they're in the buffer zone.
This would be for repair, though, of their, like the rain gardens, if they need to improve those systems.
Right.
And $500 for a tree.
For a tree.
I don't know. I don't have a number for plants.
That's like a 2 to 3 inch caliper, though. This isn't like a little
sapling. Yeah. You know, I think they had a whole planting plan for the rain garden.
Well, they do.
They do. It's on the last page.
It's herbaceous.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
so
that's not as expensive
really
as $500 tree.
Right. Right.
But there are, like I said, there are trees on the site.
I counted 10 in the back.
Those are existing trees?
No, that they're proposed.
They're proposed
yeah.
To plant.
Okay.
2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
That's,
you know,
but that's just, so that's for the trees. Seven to ten?
$10,000.
There's 10 trees and 2 rain gardens. He's going to put a fence up. There's no proposed planting beyond the fence. At least that's... So it's just 10 trees and the 2 rain gardens, and those aren't very big.
Yeah.
I mean, we're talking about his site development. I mean, it's not like, if he doesn't plant those trees, we're actually going to say, all right, well, we're going to come on your property and plant these trees. I mean, how does that work?
Well, I think we have the authority in the order.
If it's in a street, it's different, you know? Then you could...
Why would we issue a certificate of compliance?
I don't agree with that.
No, but we wouldn't. That's what I'm saying. Right. We have the certificate of compliance.
But it's a little bit stronger than that, that we therefore even have the funds with which to do it.
Yeah.
If he claims hardship or drags his feet or for whatever reason doesn't do it.
And a bond is something you buy, right?
It's an insurance. That's right.
It's not 10,000.
Well, you can put the 20,000 up if you have it and they put it in an account. But generally, I think you pay a percentage of the amount.
Yeah.
I can live with 10,000.
I think that's almost reasonable.
For this project.
I'd say somewhere between 7 and 10.
I was thinking more like 7,500. I don't know, like 2,500.
But again, I think
that's 7 to 10, like you said.
It's a number that's...
7, 10, 3, 1.5, 8, 5.
There's 5,000 in trees.
Right.
Go with 5.
8,500.
You go with that.
I mean, 8,500, you round up, it's 10.
2,500 in rain gardens. There's a lot of rain gardens.
Well, it's... But there's more to think. The rain garden is not like, let's take the top layer of grass off and plant something. That's amended soil. That needs to work right. There could be some issues. So, and the other thing about, you know, are we going to make them plant a tree? You know, I always think that, like, when someone works in the flood zone and they say, look, we're going to remove some impervious for some compensation, that you need to make sure that never gets back in the future. So.
Right.
We're making a deal here, in a sense, with the developer to make this project. And part of the reason why we've agreed to it is because of the rain gardens and the planting. So I think it's appropriate to protect that interest with a bond. Now, it doesn't need to be 2,000 or 10,000. That's really up to you guys. But I do think it's appropriate because it's the entire concept. And if you went out there and you saw the contractor just dig up a hole in the ground and then throw some mulch on it and throw some plants in it, it's not really working. We've actually asked them to prove that the infiltration rate is correct for those rain gardens. So there's more to it than just, you know, a couple of plants. So it's significant,
right,
in this project.
I wouldn't vote to eliminate it, but
I think
we're at a good point.
Yeah. So.
8,500?
I agree with that.
Okay.
Is there any objections?
So
no objections.
Does anybody want to make a motion to that effect?
Make a motion for the bond to be 8,500.
Reduce it to 8,000.
All those. Sorry. Go ahead.
I guess
old habits die hard.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
Let me back up. We don't have to do that. We're just going to change
Isn't
that.
Isn't it just an edit in the...
It's an edit.
It's not a motion.
So,
right.
So we all agree.
So let's rescind that motion. We
sort
all
of semi-formally.
Okay.
Oh,
yep.
You know what? You don't even have to worry about it because the minutes taker was like dazing out right there. So.
All right. So we had a discussion
about the
bond, and we finally rested upon $8,500. That's
so,
all it needs to go.
And then let's just find out if we're going to just make a motion to, or not a motion, just are we going to keep a portion of the bond for a couple of years for survivability or not?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I think we need to retain.
Yes.
For 2 years.
10%, 20%. Do we have not determined that right now? 25%, 50%. What do you think is a reasonable amount for a guarantee that they're going to live? You know, they plant all these trees and...
We must have some standard language for that. Do we have some?
We don't have any.
We don't have standard.
I would think that some of them are going to live and some of them aren't. So,
yeah.
Is half going to live? They're probably all going to live.
I think
it's likely
okay.
That unless something seriously wrong happens and Brandon, this doesn't work out for Brandon, then it's an owner that's going to take care of his property and water those things.
Yeah.
And that.
Yeah.
So
no,
I'm not really
thinking
there's going to be a problem.
Yeah.
But
Yeah, but you're not the snow plower. Like,
yeah.
Jams
well,
into those trees.
That is,
skins
that is
the bark.
And then he'll be paying for it. Yeah.
And the salt.
I'm sorry I didn't get comments about the order of conditions to you. I know you sent it out ahead of time. Is there something in there that calls out for the additional protection and care taken for monitoring wells that are installed there?
There is not.
I'd like...
Other than the part that it says that he will be working with an LSP during this process.
Well, I think she's probably talking more about maintaining the grade and elevation and protecting the monitoring wells from being hit during construction. That's the.
I mean, it's going to be incredible to see what the count is after all the construction staging.
Exactly.
Yeah, but those wells, I mean, you know, they're $5,000 to $10,000 a pop.
And they have to be adjusted appropriately. They can't,
you know,
just,
and they're long-term monitoring locations for an existing MCP site.
Well,
they really need. So, is there maybe we can just put something in there to at least flag the issue?
Can you come up with some language? Do you want?
Sure, I can. Every effort will be made.
But we can do it right now.
I can do this. You know, every effort will be made to locate. To locate and protect existing monitoring wells during site development.
Yep, that's perfect.
That's about it.
And they need to be repaired. We need to make provision to repair them if they're damaged. Are they going to be removing head covers to get something in? They should be putting those back in.
Well, that part's going to be a little tricky because you know, damage, I'm sure, was done by all that construction.
I'm thinking that, is it really up to us to maintain? Well, those monitoring wells are Tyree's problem, Mike Richard. And,
they are.
And,
I think just calling
the
attention.
They're trying to, I think it's
a
good idea.
I just
want to
make sure that it's flagged in there so that.
But Mike hasn't talked to me at all about what's going on. And then
right.
I warned Brandon 2 years ago about having people out there, but. You know, what's happened here
is out of my control.
Based
but
on, you know, like the sensitivity of those wells, but they're just moving forward and you know, every effort will be made to locate and protect the monitoring
really
wells
is beyond our purview.
During construction.
Yeah, can we hold them to that then? Yeah.
We can't.
Well, we can, that can be part of their construction restriction. Yes, we can tell them.
What
you know, that they have to watch out for certain things on the
but
site.
It's not a wetland and issue. What's
they're
the,
looking for a
well,
closeout.
It is a wetland issue because the contamination that was there, the old gas station contamination, has over years migrated to the wetlands. I mean, that's an ongoing hazardous waste site. It's not closed yet.
But if it's not closed and they lose...
They're going to lose wells.
And
you know,
wells.
and
I'm sure they've got a reporting period. If they lose wells and they can't, you know, accurately within their reporting required reporting, say, well, this is what we're seeing now. That it's not going to be accepted, and they're going to have to put more back in.
Right.
Again, that's I guess it's still not really part of wetland protection in that.
I would argue that it is.
But not
because of the...
Not within the Wetlands Protection Act, I don't think. I think that's tough.
Because I'll tell you, in my experience, there's a number of sites I've seen where, you know, wells are just, over the years, either they degrade because of use over the years or frost heave or what have you, or, you know, some field vehicle hit it or you know, somebody vandalized one. You know, somebody went, oh, what's this? Let's pop this open and stuff it with whatever I've got in my hand. You know, I mean, people do all sorts of crazy stuff.
Or big construction staging and then all of a sudden
or big construction staging.
Nobody...
You know, I just, I mean, maybe not necessarily the language of every care, but like care will be taken to...
I think that statement's sufficient.
It's fine, yeah. What about, the only thing we need to put in there is someone said something about grading. Is that, do you want to throw the grading part in there? I think you mentioned it prior.
I, like you said, I think that's their their issue.
It's yeah, it's not going to be us that goes puts them back in and says, "Hey, look, I was looking for my well. It used to be here, and now you know there's a pizza
box." They really, you know.
Every effort will be made to locate and protect the monitoring wells during construction.
Yeah.
That's going to be added. And then we're going to do $8,500 on a bond.
You could add a sentence that says changes to the monitoring wells need to be, the owner needs to be notified, or the, whatever they call it. The monitoring company has to be notified or whatever.
I don't even know about that.
I'm tempted to leave that because the next people who come to monitor are going to come back and the field people are going to go back to the office and go, it was a 2-hour job because there's only one well there. That's all I could find. And then that'll all play out in the office.
So what usually ends up happening? That will they have to... So they're trying to get a closeout. A bunch of wells have been destroyed. But if you really think about the site, a lot of the wells are in the back. They're not going there.
Yeah.
There was one up front on the entrance that may have got destroyed. Where they're parking is where they removed all the material.
Right.
The new material went in.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
So...
That's true.
It could be...
So if...
Lucky.
The best case scenario for them, they lose it. They lose one up front, they say.
That's the one they don't want to lose.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, no, that's the one that keeps getting hits.
Oh, well, as I say,
that's
the
one close to the road.
Yeah.
That's one close to the road. You know, the groundwater gradient in that site is flat. So, you know, some days it's tilting a little bit that way towards a wetland. Some days it's tilting toward the road. Some days it's tilting towards the car dealership. You know, it's literally flat, so...
If not
to do
a
groundwater
town,
contour map.
That would be an open wetland right
be
now.
Interesting
it would be.
Get going.
It would be. So it just, it's like standing on a balance board. It just kind of...
All right.
So that's that. Any other questions? Oh, sorry. She was going through her list. Unless you're...
All right.
Have...
I don't have anything else.
Okay.
No, just an aside. What is going across the street? It used to be the tuxedo place.
That's
very
Perfectos.
That's
Perfectos
a three-story tuxedo place.
And
Perfectos
it looks
Cafe.
Like they're going to make a lot of bread there.
It's a very odd... I like the windows, but then there's no windows here. It's kind of an odd look.
Oh, go around back through the apartment building and look. It's
at the back wall.
It's probably 3 feet away from the brook, but it's real. It looks like it's a foot away from the brook.
No, it's built in. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's
the
built
wall,
into
the
brook. The
foundation wall is almost.
Well,
like
did that come before
the
us?
Edge of the brook.
Yes.
It did. And as a matter of fact, it was such a tough permit, they had to leave that half of the foundation. They were going to underpin it. Mm. I don't know what they ended up doing. They did something different, but that piece of foundation was left and they built on top of it.
Right.
So this thing, you know, what's reasonable? Is that it's moved closer to the stream by about an inch or two, you know, like a little bit of an overhang when they tried to straighten out the forms and something like that.
You know, they removed 5 underground storage tanks on that site recently.
It's just so close
five
to that stream. And then he has to do restoration.
They kept finding them.
Do you think that's a residual of that oil company up the street?
Maybe.
Maybe. That project has been such a large issue for the property owner because also over the winter time I found out over the winter time that property owner was there with somebody in his family, and while that family member was walking near the sidewalk, they got hit by a car.
Come on,
ay ay ay.
So
well,
it's been
it on
so it's been
yeah.
This has been you know.
I hate to hear that.
If I believed in curses, you know, I'd be like this is. It's a challenging site on a lot of different levels.
It's getting done. It's moving forward.
Yeah.
They've been pretty good. Everything I've asked, they've done. Max has been, you know, on top of it. He's another owner who's going to be right there, and he cares.
Right.
Yeah.
He can't.
He does,
yeah.
He's jumped through a lot of hoops from the town.
Yeah.
So. How are we doing on this order of conditions? Are we ready for signatures?
Well, if I know Mike looked at it, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I made those changes that you suggested, and I took out basically what you had for changes. I agreed with, and I took those out. And sometimes when you know, it's all blurry, but so it's good for people to look at it. So I made every one of those changes, and I have this small list here. What we're going to add to it, and then you can sign it.
So this has already been approved, or no? All right. So I make a motion that we accept the order of conditions as amended.
We got to start back from. You got to close the hearing.
We didn't close the hearing yet.
I don't think we did.
All right.
If we had minutes, we'd know. But
I make a motion that we close the hearing for 306 Main Street, DEP 270-0641.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay, I make a motion that we accept the order of conditions as amended tonight.
Second.
For the same 270-0641.
Second.
Second. All those in favor? Okay.
And then you want to just sign it. And there's two here to sign, too.
Two other copies?
No, I want to have the emergency certification form for the Landers Road signed by the commission. And then it's Mr. Duffy's, what was it, 128?
RDA. Yeah.
Yeah, the 128
Grove. Send them.
So that's been back that way. So I'll talk about what you're signing. I'll talk about the minor projects. I have a minor project for 88 Timberneck Swamp, Timberneck Drive, where it was for two sonotubes. The deck was built, but permits were never pulled. It was discovered that the sonotubes weren't up to today's standards, so they had to put in two new ones. They were... met all the criteria for a limited project. So that one is, we took care of that. 20 Fox Run Lane, they were going to remove the 24-foot above ground pool and install 13 by 38 foot deck, which would, it's actually closer to the house, becomes part of the house. It met the criteria, that was approved.
Come on, this might be your camera. Okay.
All right. Let's see.
So
what this
while you're
is.
On that subject.
So wait a minute, I have a couple more if you want to hear them.
Sorry, go ahead.
Although these, they all met the criteria. There's nothing I feel like is questionable. So if you don't want me to talk about the other ones, 3 Estate Lane, also constructed a two-season porch, constructed a two-season room on the existing deck. So all these are simple, and won't cause much harm, and I usually don't even ask for erosion control on these types of projects.
Okay.
That's saying something for you.
That sounds like a lot of business.
So
for minor projects.
So now minor,
if it's needed, I ask.
Minor project, Chuck and I were discussing how we have these recurring things that come up. If you could, for the next meeting or the meeting after, just give some thought as to what, I think we probably need to revise our minor project list. I think there are some things that could probably go on there that aren't on there now. So if you could.
I could send around the existing minor project list.
Yeah, I think that makes sense.
And then
that's
you guys could add to it.
Okay.
And we also want to look at the RDAs.
Right.
And what I want from the commission is something like, if it's a foundation inside the 100-foot, this is just an example, then it's a notice of intent, no matter what, okay? Or if it's a foundation within 80 feet, it's a notice of intent. So come up with something solid, because the regulations make that a notice of intent no matter what. And when Mr. Duffy came in here and did his addition just going up,
it's a perfect example.
That one probably could have been a minor project.
I think
permit.
It could have been.
You know, it seems like with the ability to keep it a minor project permit, because sometimes we'd like to have erosion control. So I'd like to have the ability to have some control over it if it's needed, or just say no, not a problem. And these minor project permits are at the most, they're going to be 24 hours before you receive it.
Right. Now, a minor project permit, can you say, in a minor project permit, can you say, it's a minor project, but you need erosion control? Can you say that?
I can say that because we work with the building department, and they're, you know, Glenn will back us up. He does that, but he says if it ever becomes a problem, you know, it's only so far he can go. These
right.
are your regulations. You need to, you know, keep your own house in order. So no one's ever said, I'm not going to put erosion control up.
I mean, it's something that would be a minor project with erosion control, straw water would probably be fine. The nice part about erosion control is it almost, you know, it sets your limit of work, and you're not going to go beyond that.
Yeah.
So I think that's nice. You know, that might make us able to put some more in that category that we might not.
So let's think about that. So you could, instead of, so unless like 10, you know, think about what Glenn said and think about what we want to do. Maybe you could have a minor project permit that requires erosion control.
Right.
Just, you know, no, I mean, you know, by accepting this minor project permit,
right.
you must install erosion control.
Right.
You know, on the permit.
Right.
So
why not? I mean, that's... So that might allow us to go when we normally would have been at 80 feet, let's say, and I'm just throwing numbers out, to 60 feet or whatever. I'm just saying, it might allow us to approve more as a minor project that we're not approving now because we have that one additional. I'm not talking about getting crazy and saying, oh, we need this, that, and the other.
Yeah.
But just the erosion control might allow us to get a little closer.
Yeah, so if the minor project permits are usually sonotubes, you know, and people are agreeing to put the fill outside the buffer zone or remove it from the site, watch the trash, and call me to inspect when it's done. So those seem fine.
And we have your oversight, so.
And what's the distance, and what are these projects that are okay?
Right.
I mean,
right.
just think about this. You guys are allowing 50 feet away an above-ground pool.
Yeah, that's some serious.
So what else kind of has that disturbance?
Yeah.
That, I mean, I don't even think the roof or a second floor on top of an existing house has that much disturbance.
No.
So that's.
But, an above-ground pool, that's a one-day project, maybe 2 days. They excavate it, and it goes in, and it's done.
Yeah, we did have the one guy. The one
unless,
guy,
of course, you're doing it yourself.
The guy excavated it and then dumped it into
the wetland?
Dumped it.
Get
close
out.
To, yeah, no, he didn't dump it in the wetlands. He dumped it where some other dumping was happening, and she thought it was okay. So,
So give that some thought.
So
we can actually, you know, if we can keep him out of this room, that would be good.
Yeah, the discussion would be great. I mean, a lot of times that you have a simple project, like no matter how simple it is, it has to be a notice of intent,
right.
because in our regulations you can't get a variance without a notice of intent. So you might want to think about other situations where you could get a variance.
Without a notice of intent, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe a variance is okay to ask for just on its own.
So these little things are coming up that, you know, obviously Chuck's been here a while, and you know, I think this would make all of our lives easier, I think, you know, so
because
as long as we don't reduce the protection for the resource area.
You always have to think about the next people that are going to be sitting in your chairs too, so you don't want to make it so loose that, you know, but you think about it. This would be a good conversation to have Tom back here. He would make us flow chart or something like that. And
right?
Figure it out. So
now, administrator's report, do you have anything to report?
Not at the moment.
Okay. We signed the emergency permit.
Yeah.
That's it.
Oh, let me...
What about bills? No bills?
Oh, yeah, you got any bills?
I have one thing to report. I was just taking a minute to get to my right page. A 181 South Street, Mr. Wise, Thomas Wise, he came before us before, and he had riverfront and buffer zone. And he was in the outer 100 for most of his project. He was going to reconfigure the garage, put on a family room, put a driveway on the other side of the house. He's no longer going to do the driveway. on the other side of the house. We've agreed to that. So that impervious inside the outer 200 foot, the outer 100 foot riverfront area is going away.
Mm-hmm.
But he has to turn the two car garage into a three car garage, and he has to turn it on its axis, and then create a little bit more driveway to make the corner around there. He's going to come in and ask if he can have a minor plan change for that. And what he's going to show you is what's impervious before, what we agreed to, and how much the increase is. The new project will still be outside the 100-foot buffer and outside the first 100-foot of the riverfront area. So this is a 200-foot impact zone that we're talking about here on a project that we've already approved.
All right. We'll see it when it comes in, then.
Okay.
Yeah. That's good. Anybody else have any?
Does anyone think that instantly that's supposed to be a amended order of conditions?
Nope. Not necessarily. Not without seeing it.
Well, I'd like to see what plans
it sounds like
in.
It's a big deal.
Well, what's the difference in the impervious surface in
it looks
the
like it's going to be like 60 feet, 60 square feet.
And on his property, what is that area between the 100 and the 200 riverfront area?
What is it? It's existing lawn, house, and driveway.
How big is it? Do you know?
How much square footage?
Yeah, because I thought it was based on a percentage of that area or those areas.
No, it's that. No, it's in the first 100 foot. All that stuff's in the first 100 foot.
Okay.
Like, the length of the stream or the river and
okay.
the first 100 feet, and you can't alter that and all that. But outside the 100 foot, you really can allow these things. So, it's just the impervious, and you have to make up for that if you want to.
Right. I mean, there's going to be some compensation
with
infiltration there, I think. So that really kind of really negates it because you're putting it back into the ground.
It doesn't sound significant enough for,
right.
for
he's really
right.
far away. He has a house between house and a yard, someone else's, between him and the river. It's mostly lawn. It's mostly lawn in the first 100 foot also.
Yeah, it doesn't sound like it. It sounds like a non-issue, so.
Yeah. It's you know, and it's a situation where these, you know, there's a hardship thing going on here. The room's for his parents, they're moving in, the car, and why they need three-car garage is because some sort of regulations where you got to get everything off the street.
It's not because he's getting an Aston Martin or anything.
Or he's renting it. No, I don't know.
I've seen a few Maseratis in town, but anyway, I digress again. Anything else come before the commission?
I just want to ask about, Chuck, you've had your eye on a certain property along Lowell Street. Were they doing a basketball court in the backyard?
Oh, yeah.
I assume that it's getting bigger.
I went there with the chair
of
the commission.
Have we had any... Okay, what's happening there? Have we had any interaction? Do we have any? Did they pull any permit or anything for that?
What's your worry about that? Weren't you here at the commission? I think that they
no, they came.
Yeah, they came before us.
They filed.
Oh, okay, okay.
They filed for
an RDA.
Maybe that was the one meeting I missed. There's one I missed in the last couple
of
months. Okay.
So that's like.
So that
I'm
is under permit.
I'm not going to rehash that, but
okay. No, I saw basketball net going in.
They came before us.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, they're not just doing what they want.
Okay.
Well,
drive past slowly and repeat that again to yourself.
I do. I do see it. Anyway.
The integrated vegetative management plan.
Oh, here's another one. Yeah.
What's the?
Oh, that's right.
They were
that's
here.
Right.
We didn't talk to them about that.
Well,
I don't think they were the same.
No,
yeah.
They weren't the same people.
Unless it's their environmental good.
No, aren't they supposed to submit to us formally?
No. Well,
no,
I don't think we ever
one.
Decided.
There's a new one.
They want to put together a new vegetative management plan.
One that we haven't. It's the one that we got the email for, right?
We got one email.
With it was attached.
Right, and then they were going to, Chuck had some comments based on our comments,
right,
and then they were going to come back with a new vegetative management plan.
We sent him an email saying that in its current form, we will not sign this.
Right, right.
And then Matt Brown got back to me and said that we're actually not even going to ask any of the towns to sign it anymore, and they're going to...
Apparently, because they probably get some more. Some more.
Becky came up with some great, she looked at it, I looked at it, she was able she was able to really identify what she was looking at and what she read and what was needed. And I gave him about three or four of your list of three or four pages. And
well, I had almost a page.
She had a ton of comments.
I almost had a page.
And
I
then,
had like eight comments. Before.
So I said, Matt, I asked him, I said, we're not ready to sign it. These are some of the things we're thinking about that need to be tightened up. Why don't you come to the commission and talk to us so we get an understanding of what we're looking for? And he was like, well, we're not going to have you guys sign anymore or any of the towns. We're having it rewritten. And then his only other comment was, what does it take to get a general permit? So, very positive,
good
feedback.
Good.
And then in the meantime, we're just doing that tree by tree, pole by pole survey that we have to do every time, Meyer Tree Service is in town. And if anyone else can think of a better way to do that, I'd be happy, but it's okay that we're looking at each tree.
Are they in touch with you on a regular basis for that?
Well, I think there was no communications for a long time, and right now it's like I know Matt, me and Matt talk a lot, and he gets back to me, and it works out fine. Meyer, I haven't heard from them, but Bob Keating is, he's not going to let this thing go. He's our watchdog also.
Yeah.
So it's me and Bob and the commission, and we're all saying save the trees, don't cut them down, and make sure there's a good reason why these have to come down.
And he's doing a great job, by the way.
Bob Keating.
I see new trees everywhere, and they have those gator bags around them. And they cut down some trees over here. I can't remember the name of the street. Last season, two new trees to replace them this season. Right opposite the location. They took the stumps out, everything last year.
I actually have a question, because when we got this plan, I started thinking,
it's going to be the worst minutes in the world.
They cut everything. Okay?
Right.
You have to.
Right.
Now we're talking local distribution.
Did I get the pen back?
So when I'm looking at the trees,
so if you take minutes here.
Holes.
The wishbone.
I see a canopy above and then a hole, and it's like
a donut.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, well, something hits that could go down on that line.
Yeah.
Do they cut the top or not? Don't look like they do. One of the things that's endemic of all these utility companies is they don't maintain their rights of way often, and you get a lot of growth. So everybody's kind of used to this growth. Then they come in with asplund.
And then all of a sudden,
everything's drastic.
Yeah.
Because
it's drastic looking,
it hasn't
but
been
guess
maintained.
What?
Yeah.
You want your electricity.
Yeah.
Right.
So, but
it'd be interesting to see that when it comes in.
So that was what?
I think Meyer actually drafted this plan.
Meyer.
Tree service.
Yes, they did. Yeah, they did. Yeah. Mike, did you have comments on it?
I have very minor. I just wanted to see where it was at. I don't think I saw that you saw your comments.
My comments went to the chair and to Chuck.
All right.
Oh, that's why.
Because I wasn't going to open a discussion.
She was on fire. She was too. I've only got through three pages.
Well,
I don't know if I CC'd you.
So
we don't
after
have to
you get through
about,
the spelling mistakes.
Well, they really got me when the comment there was one of the paragraphs in there says, when they go into a trail to do brush clearing, they can leave up to 2 feet of brush behind. I was just like, wait a minute. Anywhere you want? Like, no, you can't. You have to, there's resource area around there. And can't just leave piles and piles in your wake.
Maybe they meant this way. You don't know. You don't, didn't know.
No, they did. They said 2 feet in height.
Oh,
up
really?
To 2 feet in height.
I missed that one.
Yeah, no.
I guess my only concern was, you know, less of this one, but, you know, I know when Chuck sent this email, we were looking for a general permit because we all kind of thought that this, what they were doing right now was in some sort of general permit, and
yeah.
There was nothing.
Right. Right.
You know, as of right now, we've got something that, you know, that they're calling him or
yep.
Yeah.
We weren't.
The tree by tree method.
Yeah. Or,
yeah.
You know, as of right now, there's nothing there.
Yeah, those general permits are scary too. I mean, that would have been kind of tough to write.
Yeah.
Because you have RMLD subbing it out to somebody else who's working pole to pole piecemeal, if you will, and the faster they go, you know, the more money they can make. So to make these quick decisions and to say stop and hold on and call people is what's been the problem. So
I don't think it's impossible, but I think it requires a carefully laid plan that allows them to do their job without slowing them down, but may even penalize them if they decide to go a little faster and not pay attention to the
parameters.
To the general permit. You know?
And the general permit has to address the parameters
right.
under which they cut
right.
and notify.
Right.
Yeah.
Like the town's general permit, the one that the DPW sent us.
Yeah.
I thought it was very, very well done. We can give them that as a sample. Anyway. So if there's nothing else to come before the commission, I make a motion that the meeting's adjourned.
I'll second.
All those in favor, stand up.